and you take it from the bottom, how is it? It's saline. So the salt has pervaded the water. So also consciousness pervades this universe. That is why you have conscious experiences. Because you are conscious, there is experience, isn't it? If you are not conscious, a robot, does it experience the world? No. Why? It works only according to your program. It doesn't experience anything because it is not self-aware. You are self-aware, so you are experiencing this world. So isn't the science of awareness important to understand the world? Tell me. Consciousness is intrinsic to experience. If you want to understand human consciousness, this is what is called subjective science. Then further, whole of Yoga Vedanta is nothing but subjective science. Tremendous ideas they are giving you. Enormous tools for self-perfection, self-inquiry. But we are conveniently ignoring all of that. See, it's all in scientific format. They don't ask us to believe anything. Then further on, he says, the father says, you see, honey, take the example of honey. Honey is a mixture of the nectar of so many flowers. But can you actually pinpoint this sweetness, this bit of sweetness is from this flower, this taste is from this flower? You can't do that. It's all mixed up, isn't it? But it's the nectar collected from a whole lot of flowers. So also the nectar of life, consciousness. You can't pinpoint, it is here, it is here, it is from this, it is from that. But you are experiencing, you are tasting life through it. Tasting means experiencing life through consciousness. How can you ignore this science? One more, he gives a number of examples. I will just give one more example and stop the story so that we will go into our further discussion. Then he says, look at all these small rivulets. They are merging, tributaries, small rivulets coming down the mountain and merging to create a huge river. Now, once they merge into that river, and the river goes and merges into the ocean, can you pinpoint this is water from that rivulet? This is water from there? It's water. It's all water. So also, if you drop name and form, you will go to the essential substance of things. That substance is nothing but consciousness. Tattvamasi Shvetaketu. Even as there is only water, taking different names and forms, in the form of a rivulet, in the form of a tributary, in the form of a river, so also one consciousness in different names and forms is the manifold universe. This mind-boggling variety, at the heart of it is Brahman, consciousness. So this is you, O Shvetaketu, Tattvamasi Shvetaketu. Again and again, 9 times he says this. And that is why I understand your real nature is pure consciousness. Atman is not a theory. It is the essence, the core of your personality, which is of the nature of pure consciousness. It is existence itself, because it doesn't require something else to make it exist. It renders everything conscious, because it is consciousness itself. It is consciousness itself, existence itself, and so it is bliss itself. It stands independent. So it is happy. Not that it is happy, it is the cause for happiness. This is the source of your personality structure, pure consciousness. If even a bit of this knowledge comes into our life, you know, your mind will naturally turn within. And you will do very good science. All problems which we have with our studies, with our, you see, they are mental problems, problems with your mind. What are the types of problems we have with our minds? Tell me. All problems have to do with our minds. Okay, right? Or the other person is the problem. Tell me. Is the other person the problem or my mind? Even if there's a problem there, if my mind was in a particular state, I wouldn't recognize that as a problem. So ultimately the problem is here. Now, the problems with our mind are overthinking, wrong thinking, wrong conditioning, negativities, which includes all this anger, hate, jealousy, all this. So all these keep our mind busy along very negative lines. Because of the lack of this knowledge, if your mind touched its source, consciousness, it will remain absolutely crystal clear all the time. Then won't you do better science with that type of mind, tell me? More creative science you will do. But if the mind is over cluttered with unnecessary things, because it is just, you know, waving on the surface, it has not touched its source, then it cannot, even a simple concentration is a problem. Simple concentration is a problem for many people, you know. I work with IIT Delhi. There, a whole lot of students are sometimes they commit suicide. That suicidal tendency is there. So if you ask them why, what's your exact problem, tell me, then they, you know the answer, I can't stop this. When people shoot themselves, those who commit suicide, I'm saying, you know where they shoot themselves? Here, because they want to stop this, can't bear it anymore. So why should we reduce ourselves to this state? Why should this happen in human life, this glorious life with which, you see, with this instrument you can achieve the highest. You can achieve God. And you can do so much for this world. Why should you want to destroy it? Because this is not stopping. Then you must learn the technique to pause this, to control this. This is basic to every really advanced mind. You must know how to control the mind, how to pause it, how to keep your emotions, regulate your emotions. Then only you can achieve the highest in life and a really fulfilling life. Isn't this true? So that is why we should be able to draw from the Upanishads, from our Yoga Sutras, to understand these basic facts of life. They are giving us all the tools which we require. You know, the standard methods which are prescribed in Vedanta are very interesting. How do I control my mind? How do I get this knowledge of the self? How do I discover who am I? The standard three methods, you must have heard of it. What are the three methods given in Vedanta? Shravan, Manan and Nididhyasan. So what is Shravan? Hearing Vedanta again and again. Why? Otherwise we'll forget. You know, the nonsense in the mind will become more important. Your movies, which occupy so much of your emotion, become dominate. Every day, if you don't touch this reality, at least 10 minutes, the first, I would say, half an hour of your morning, the first half an hour, should be given to something of this, isn't it? It will charge up your mind with positivity. It will refresh your entire system. First half an hour of your day. In IIT, you know, the time when we get up in the morning is the time when they go to sleep. That is 3:30 a.m. They are working in their labs till 3:30. So then I tell them, okay, whatever time you get up, maybe they get up at 7:30 or... So the first half an hour, you must give to the touch of this consciousness, not just your silly mind activity, which you have anyway no hold over. Tell me, are you thinking or is thinking happening? Thinking is happening, no, most of the time. So you see the condition of the mind. It's not just about your mind. Everybody's mind is like that. Unless there is Vedanta vichar, it will not pause. It will go on with its... After some time, you get so tired of it. You are actually... You know, when people go for getaways, they want to go to Andaman, Nicobar or Dubai or... They are actually trying to get out of their minds. They are so fed up with it. But wherever you go, the mind will go with you. See, isn't it? You don't get new mind when you go to Dubai. You get new mind. You are actually trying to escape your mind. So you plan costly getaways, but you will go there and keep thinking of the same silly things. So the actual instrument which we should be able to change is the mind. And self-knowledge directly leads to that. Because you go to the very source of your mind. You are cleansing it from within. Isn't it? That is what this Vedanta is about. It is a means, a tool to enrich human life. It is a tool to attain the goals you want to attain. It is, please understand this, it is not meant for Himalayan caves. It was discovered there that silence is required at some time for this penetration. But its greatest usage is to human society, to our society. So try to bring something of this. First, it should come in our lives. Isn't it? Then you will radiate it in your workplace. More balanced behavior, more control over the mind, better relationships, refined relationships, and better interaction in your workplace. It will refine you in every way from within. This is the great utility of this knowledge. So Shravan is what you have to keep hearing Vedanta again and again. Otherwise, I told you what will happen. Emotions will come and dominate. All sorts of thought currents will dominate. Every day, can't you give 10 minutes to this elevating literature? Tell me that first half an hour which I said in the morning. 10 minutes you can read something from the Upanishads, Bhagavad Gita, Vivekananda. It will lift your mind. Make it part of your life. Self-improvement, self-knowledge is the first thing as young people you should opt for. Then we will try to improve the world. Second step, that is. First step is self-improvement. So, Shravan, again and again hearing Vedanta. Second step is Manan, thinking repeatedly about it. It is not enough to hear. It must become part of my thought process. How do I make it part of my thought process? By analyzing it, accommodating it into my intellect, soaking up in it. See, there are so many clues to the presence of the self in your everyday life. If you do a little manan, you will understand the value of this. Can I give you a few clues here? Two, three. It's available to your experience right now. Not that you have to go into meditation and then you will understand. Right now, you can try to see what the I means. See, in your own life, please sit erect, all of you, young people especially, because to grasp this, no, you need alertness. Okay, let me give you this as the first clue. You require some amount of effort on your part, intention on your part to think in a particular line, isn't it? You require some amount of effort to will, isn't it? You require effort to emote, which means emotion. Do you require any effort to be aware, self-aware, which means what? Self-aware is your real nature. You don't require effort because you are aware, you are thinking, you are willing, you are having emotions, right? So awareness is fundamental to everything else. Because you are self-aware, you are having all of the other experiences. So awareness is your real nature. Thought comes afterwards. Right? Is it your experience or not? Then only I will proceed. Your experience? See, if you manage to remove thought a bit from your mind, at least a few fractions of a second, you will understand you are there. Thought is not there. Yoga means this only, chitta vritti nirodh. You are there watching the absence of thought. You are there watching the presence of thought and you are there watching the absence of thought. So you as awareness always are there. You always persist. Thoughts come and go in that awareness. This basic thing you should understand. Then you will not be intertwined with your thought world. You are a little distant from it naturally. Right? Let me give you one more clue here. See if this makes sense to you. See, you were an infant a long time back. Today, if I show you your picture of your infanthood, you may not recognize that is you. Only your mother will recognize it. That much the body has changed, mind has changed. That same you became a toddler. And you did so many things in that state, which also you don't remember today. Then you became a teenager. The same I has persisted, although body and mind have completely changed. You became a teenager. You had the experiences of that stage of life. Then you are a young person now. You are getting on in years. But the same I, although body has completely changed, mind has completely changed. How is this? That means there is something in you which is a constant. The real I is unpunctuated by time and space. Otherwise, how do you know that same thing is I? You are a continuum without reference even to one particular body. Are you catching this point? It's in your own experience. See, you pass through all these different stages of life and the same I pass through it. Body and mind changed completely at every stage. But you claim the same I. That was me. That was the infant. The same infant was the toddler. The same was the teenager. And the same I is now this. So I has persisted, a sense of I, but not with reference to one particular body. One particular stage of life. Which means there is some continuity in you which is not related to the body merely. You are a continuum without reference to one particular body. If you think about this again and again in a clear state of mind, you will see the truth in this. Our I sense is always a subject and this is an object to it. That is why the I persists even when the body changes. Even when the mind, your thoughts change. Everything has changed about you, but the same I is there. So all these things, na, puna puna, puna puna, you have to think about it. This is manan. If you apply, you know, relativity physics is like that. First time you heard of it, what crazy it felt like that. Bizarre it is. Second time you hear of it, well, acceptable. Third time, it makes more sense. Fourth time, that is the truth. So also is Vedant. First time you hear, are, can this be true? Second time you hear, more sense it will make. Third time you are convinced of it. If you do it in a very clear state of mind, after your morning yoga meditation, you will be immediately convinced of it. You are pure consciousness functioning through a body-mind complex. All the time. So getting mixed up merely with what is objective to your experience doesn't befit the human experience. This is what Vedanta is telling you. Rise above it. You are far above it. Vivekananda used to give this message repeatedly, isn't it? All power is within you. You can do anything and everything. Believe in this because you are the giving this example, you cannot see this potency of this seed, but it manifests as this huge tree. Imagine this. So also consciousness is at the heart of manifestation. You are not able to see it, but don't conclude it is not there. It can be intuited in a pure mind. Reality, if there is no mind training, yoga. So the first three states, mudha, kshipta and vikshipta, are the reality for most people. And you are doing all your science and politics and great decisions for the nation in these three states. Isn't it? So how will the world run? How will the world be? That's why it is what it is. Because the nature of our mind is what it is, the world is what it is. So if I improve the nature of my mind, I will do everything better in a different way. Isn't it? So the fundamental thing to change this world is to change the quality of our minds, the quality of our thinking from within. Not that from outside some changes are being made over me. Not like that. From within, I have understood the nature of my thought process and mind, and that is why I am able to make this change within myself. So self-knowledge brings you this. It's a starting point of making any great change in the world. You know, Gandhiji used to say this, you must be the change that you want to see in the world. Which means mind must be of that order. So with Nididhyasana, this naturally comes. The sattvic state where you are able to experience ekagra and niruddha states. This will come naturally with the practice of Nididhyasana. Now, let me go into some of the practical effects of this which will help you. See, pursuing who am I and getting a knowledge of what we are calling the Atma Tattva, the self. Most of all, what it does to you is it clears your mind tremendously. Great clarity persists in the mind. Awareness dominates the thought process. So thought is not bizarre and over-cluttered and not stopping, and all these problems will not be there. Emotions will be very regulated in life. As a result, you will be strong and confident. Where there is clarity, there is confidence. Isn't it? Confidence doesn't come with just degrees. It comes when you are sure of yourself from within. Right? So you will naturally develop all this. It will come naturally into our lives if there is self-knowledge. And without this knowledge, you know, you never know where the mind will take you. That's why this self-knowledge, or whatever we are calling subjective knowledge, it's not an option. Like you choose subjects in IISc, you can't do that with this knowledge. If you don't have it, well, your mind will take you anywhere. There is an external world, there's a whole internal world. Some knowledge of this internal world you should have. You have the great philosophy of yoga and Vedanta behind you as part and parcel of this culture. You can draw enormously from it. It's totally in scientific format. And you can draw enormously from it. Now, our intelligence, we have to see how it works. Will we be able to draw from it or not? And if we are able to draw from it, concentration, attention, memory, and success is not at all an issue. It's only a matter of time. You must have read Vivekananda's life. Some of you youngsters. So there you will see very high powers of concentration. In fact, your success is directly proportional to the level of concentration of your mind. In Vivekananda's case, he could just soak in information. Once, you know, when he was in Belur Math, he had 10 volumes of Encyclopedia Britannica in his room. Shining volumes. So one of his disciples came into Sharad Chandra Chakravarti. He comes into his room and says, "Oh, Swamiji, such nice volumes." So Swamiji said, "Yes, I have brought it for reading." "And how many have you read?" Then Swamiji said, 10. 10 volumes already read? Then Swamiji said, "Yes, you can ask me anything from that." Then he picked up some random volume, and from somewhere he asked him a question. Encyclopedia Britannica, just imagine, huge volume. And Swamiji actually gave a verbatim answer, quoting almost the same thing. And then he said, "Swamiji, this is humanly not possible." And Vivekananda said, it is possible if you have a trained mind. You are just soaking in information because the mind is so concentrated like a laser beam. See, when you were a child, you were writing A, it was so difficult. A, apple, you were writing, it was so difficult. After some time, you did not have to go letter by letter. The word itself you could concentrate upon. After some time, the sentence itself makes sense. You don't have to go word, letter by letter or word by word. If you develop this kind of concentration, you go page by page. Finally, you go book by book. You just get the intent completely. Your mind has this capacity. This is what I'm telling you. You must learn to concentrate like that. And for that, a little yoga is required in life. Purity of mind is required. If the mind is just into everything, all sorts of things coming in through the senses all the time, and mind has absolutely no filter, then you know what creates your thoughts? This is important for you to know. What creates your thoughts, tell me? Yes, your sense intake. What you are taking in. This is ahar, according to Shankaracharya. You must have heard ahara shuddho, sattva shuddhi. So ahar is not just what you take from here. What you take from here, what you take from here, it's all ahar for your system. Now, what kind of ahar you are taking? Think and see. Every day. This is not a dustbin. Is this a dustbin? That you take in anything? Today, media will give you anything. You must install filters through your will so that you take in stuff which creates the right thought world, the right emotional world. Then only you can work on mind management and self-knowledge. If all sorts of nonsense is getting, see, when you are eating food, if a single hair comes into that food, what do? I don't want to eat this. You're so particular, nutrition and cleanliness. So also, this is all ahar, what you are taking in through the senses. A little control there is required for you to generate a sattvic thought world. Elevated thought and emotion. This is what? See, if you want to enjoy your youth, you must bring your mind into the sattvic state. And then you will understand what joy means, what happiness means. Otherwise, you are just pursuing something which doesn't make any sense and you can't stop. How will it be if you are riding a horse which doesn't stop? And the reins are not in your hands. How will it be? You know, that's what is happening. There's a Zen story. You are riding a horse. The reins are not in your hands and it's not stopping. So it will take you anywhere. Our mind is in this condition. So if you want to change this state of affairs, that is why, you know, concentration is a problem, negativities, then all sorts of tendencies, habits are wrong, and you're so fed up with life. By the time you step into your life, you're fed up with your mind, actually. So put the right habits. See, if you're truly intelligent, it's not enough to just have a smartphone. You must be really smart. If you're really smart, step by step, you will build your life. Every day, put the right habits. Bring the right sanskars. I told you, your thought world is generated by your senses. So, correct yourself at every step and you will create a beautiful life for yourself. You are the master of your life, of your destiny. Don't put it in somebody's hands. Don't make this mistake. You know, when people make this mistake, that point they don't understand. After some time, they regret like anything. A number of students told me, Didi, if you had just come into our lives 5 years back. So step by step, put this foundation. That is why your culture has been so cautious, so responsible, telling you Shreyas is different from prayers. It is important to focus on the right things, put the right sanskars. ನೀವು ಮನೆಗೆ ಹೋದರೆ ತಂದೆ ತಾಯಿ ಇದೇ ತಾನೇ ಹೇಳೋದು ಯಾವಾಗಲೂ ಒಳ್ಳೆ ಸಂಸ್ಕಾರ ಬರಬೇಕು ಒಳ್ಳೆ ಜೀವನ ಆಗಬೇಕು ದೇ ಕೀಪ್ ಟೆಲಿಂಗ್ ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ಂಟ್ ಇಟ್ ವೈ They know. So you must consciously put this foundation for your life so that you are able to raise a superstructure of great success and fulfillment in life. Otherwise, all sorts of unnecessary mental problems, nonsensical thoughts and emotions which are so bad you yourself can't live in that mind. See, if your room is over cluttered, what do you do? Do you clean it up or you go to live in the next room? What do you do? You go and live in friend's room, but you can't do that with your mind. If the mind is over cluttered, you can't go and live in somebody's mind. You have to clean up and live there only. Whole life you will live with your mind. So take care of it. So self-knowledge is about all of this, because your personality means body, mind, intellect and awareness. Self-awareness will help you organize your life so that all these elements of your personality are in your hands. Isn't it? These are the elements of your personality, right? So you can bring them into your hands entirely. See, when you click your selfie and you are admiring your selfie, let us suppose, young people, all of you do it. Now tell me, who's admiring whom? When you are admiring your selfie, I'm teaching you Drigdrishya Vivek in Vedant. Who's admiring whom? Your mind is admiring your body. And your intellect is acknowledging your mind, admiring your body. Right? Three elements of your personality have already come. And the whole thing is happening in your awareness. Because you are aware, your intellect is acknowledging your mind, admiring your body. So you see, this is you. Any experience, this is how you are functioning. Awareness is at the heart of your personality structure. Who am I means penetration into this core of your personality. This is what Vedanta is telling you repeatedly. Tattva masi shvetaketo. You are that. Not merely this. No, you are functioning through this. This is yours. This is not you. Knowing this, function maturely in this world. This is the message that they are giving out to you. The effects of meditation are enormous. If you practice a little meditation, all of this that we are discussing will become very clear. So I will now show you a video on meditation, the effects of meditation, practically what is happening in your brain as a result of meditation, and some slides based on that. The first video. You can put off the lights, yeah. Yeah, you can switch it on and see, maybe it will play. Look at this. Thank you.
are the three standard Vedanta
techniques which we discussed. Three steps are given for us to dive into self-knowledge. The next slide. Yes. When you ask the question, who am I? This is the answer which Vedanta will give you. The light of pure consciousness reflected in the mind pervades the buddhi. It generates empirical awareness, our sense of being. This is technically called the jiva, the entity that designates itself as I. So there is a technical answer to the question, who am I? I'll just explain this, just watch this. You see, pure consciousness is reflected in the mind and generates your sense of being. That is how you attribute to yourself the sense of being, I, which is called the jiva in Sanskrit. An enlivened entity. It is the reflection of pure consciousness in the mind. Okay, next slide. So who am I according to Vedanta is, you see, this is the model, Panchakosha model, which is given in Vedanta. At the heart of your personality structure is the Atman, enshrouded by intellect, mind, prana and body. The outermost crust of your personality is the body. Then is the vital energies, prana, then mind, then intellect, and at the heart of it is, of everything is awareness, pure awareness, what is called consciousness or Atman. So you see, even Abraham Maslow once said, what is necessary to change a person is to change his awareness of himself. Isn't this true? If my idea of myself is I'm just the body, I will see you only as body. The value of self-knowledge. Even if there was no application, knowledge itself is all sufficient. To know is to liberate the mind, isn't it? If there was no technology, would science be less real? Tell me. The ontology of the self or Atman. It means to say, why be ethical? It is because the same consciousness is shining in all beings. It actually means another form. The same consciousness is shining in all beings. So this is at the heart of ethics, actually. This is what it means. Then it gives you a sense of universality. Because there is one common factor in the entire universe, which is consciousness. A healthy interface between different branches of knowledge. Not unity, but reconciliation between objective and subjective sciences, and hence between science and spirituality. The importance of this you will only understand when you grow up. I'm talking to the students. Antagonism between idealism and realism is wiped out. That is why in the, you know, in the Mundaka Upanishad, it is said Brahma Vidya Sarva Vidya Pratishtham, which means this Brahma Vidya is the support and source of every other Vidya. This is what they mean to say. And it will organize knowledge with respect to its capacity to unleash human potential. The entire organization of knowledge should come from your ability to function in this world. How much of your potential is... That's why, how did Vivekananda define education? Do you know, he said it is the manifestation of the perfection already in man. That is education. Not collecting a whole lot of facts from outside. You see, Google will do that for you. Why should you also do? Google will collect all facts for you and give you whenever you want. So you cultivate your higher intellect and you can penetrate into... Somebody was asking me recently in IIT, you know, artificial intelligence will take over and we will lose our jobs. This is how it is developing. You know, machine learning and artificial intelligence is developing at such a rate that at one time maybe there won't be jobs enough for humans. So I told them that that would be a very good thing because you will have all the time to do Yoga Vedanta, isn't it? Only when you don't have such interests, then you will feel, what will I do without a job? So develop the inner world. This is what I'm trying to tell. Then most of all, self-knowledge gives you a worldview entrenched in divinity. The world is sublated with God or Brahman. Okay, so let's not go into those details because it may not be very relevant to you. But the point is this. Today, if you get up in the morning and read the newspapers, you feel what a terrible world. Isn't it? That's the picture that is given to you. But if you develop this inner world, self-knowledge, you get you defy the world in a sense. And what the media is actually giving you is just a bit of what is happening somewhere. Something sensational has to be given. You must, if you develop the inner world, you get a totally different picture of life and reality. For your own sake, at least, you should do it. Isn't it? Morning, you get up, first thing you take up the newspaper, and your mind will go into circles. What is this happening? What a terrible world. This is a picture you will get. If some amount of yoga you don't bring into your life. Whenever you see we bother about all these problems happening on the outside, remember, everything started with the human mind, isn't it? Now this object, it began as a thought in somebody's mind. This object began as a thought in somebody's mind. Everything that you see in this world was a thought in somebody's mind. So if you change your ways of thinking, you are changing the world. Don't think only policy makers and Modi government changes the world or changes the nation. It starts with thought. So you rediscover higher levels of happiness. This is the bottom line, you know, as a result of self-knowledge, an original happiness, self-sustained and rising from yourself will come into your life. You don't need 100 things to keep you happy. Okay, you can end this show. You know, what is the meaning of you require things to keep you happy? Today, this is the condition of many students. So let me tell you this. I had a group of students in IIT who asked me this question. Mataji, we can't do sustained levels of concentration. When we concentrate intensely for 15 minutes, then I feel enough. It self-sustains itself. It is buoyant, it is light, it is clear, it is pure. Not too many thoughts, but very ordered thoughts. Things, at least in the mornings, at least once a day. Then do your job throughout the day. You will see the mind will be in a fresh state. Please try to do small things I have told you. Bits of information I have given you. Apply it and see. It will help you. Let's take up the question answers now. Yes. Yes.
Between self, the mind, the body and the intellect. So we listen to this after satsanga, this sin remains for a while, but then again the mind wanders, that it again starts identifying with the non-self. So one, how does one, is there any practical tips that one can take?
Yes, practical tips. See, what we do, let me tell you this, we, throughout the day, at fixed periods, we dwell on these ideas. It's not enough just, you see, if you really want to pursue a spiritual goal, you understand the self, then
what you actually want, you will repeatedly come to it, even throughout the day. So, from time to time thinking about these things. Today, you see, it's all available to you. Technology has brought these things also very close to us. On YouTube, you will get all of NRCV IIT Delhi's talks. So, every day, at fixed times, if you expose yourself, that's why I said Shravan is important. Again and again, you hear about it. And at fixed times, you think about it. Again and again, then you will be, at some point, you will be able to make this distinction between the self and non-self. How I am functioning, how this is functioning actually in this world. Practice is required for this. Isn't it? Throughout the day, a little bit of, and keeping that kind of satsang also. I am glad to see in this IISc, so many of you are interested in this. I am really very happy to see this. So, keep this kind of a company which will bring this more and more into your life. Otherwise, you know what can happen. I think you are quite familiar with it. Your mind can tangentially go off anywhere. Young minds, lot of energy will be there, but there is absolutely no level of control anywhere. So this you have to do by yourself. Shravan, Manan, you should practice constantly. Try to do it and see. Vedanta is part and parcel of our life. It is your life. It is the core truth about your life. It is not another system of thought. It is not another philosophy which somebody thought and built up. It is the core reality about your I. How can you not bring it into your life? That's why you should apply it on yourself. How is my system functioning? Not a 3D model like that Panchakosha model I showed you. Here it was 2D. Not a model like that. How is this functioning, basically? That you must understand. How is my mind functioning? Why is it functioning like this? And try to get your solace in our scriptures. Aap karte ho ye? Do you do this? A little bit of Bhagavad Gita, a little bit of Upanishads, if you study, it will refresh your mind like anything, because it is talking of the highest in you. Please try to connect with this. It should become part and parcel of our life. Not that because somebody told me or my routine. Not like that. Original interest, original love for all this. The highest is there in the Bhagavad Gita, the very essence of the Upanishads. So expose yourself to these things regularly and you can do it. Yes?
Yeah. So sometimes I'm a bit confused that what is the purpose of my life? Means I when I observe myself,
yes,
what I was in the 5 years back,
yes,
and the goal is changing in every stage of my life.
Yes.
So sometimes I feel confused the purpose of my life.
Yes. You see, every young person should know there is an ultimate goal and there's an immediate goal to every life. Your ultimate goal is always self-knowledge. Knowing yourself should be top priority, isn't it? That's why it's called the ultimate thing in life. But you have immediate goals also, because you have to sustain yourself in this world. You need a job, you need money, you need to stand on your own feet. So that's your immediate goal. You are taking a course, you are building your career for that. Along with this, you should pursue these higher goals. And at one point in your life, when you are on your own feet, when you are well established, that will become the top priority, the ultimate thing in your life. But if at this age you don't cultivate this love, this relationship with your own self, then you know that this is what will happen. When the job goes or something happens in the family, something happens, you just topple over. Or artificial intelligence will take up my job. Then what will I do? I'll go crazy without a job. So all these problems only come when you don't have a higher goal to relate to. Isn't it? So always remember, ultimate goal of life is there. That is what we are calling self-knowledge. And your immediate goal, you must keep building your life along these lines, because you need to survive in this world. So combine the two right now. Not running away from this. Combine the two. At one point in your life, that goal alone will matter. Right? Yes.
How is existence different from consciousness?
Very beautiful. See, actual Vedantic question. How is existence dependent on consciousness?
Different from or dependent?
Different. On? Different. No. See, existence is not different from consciousness. Existence is conscious. Why is consciousness alone considered to be the heart of existence? Is because you cannot experience anything without consciousness. Can you? Now suppose you are unconscious. The whole world is there. You are not able to experience it. Only when you are self-aware, fully conscious, then you can experience the world. And you can, if you enhance this awareness, this consciousness, you can experience it better. Have you seen this? If you are only half awake in the morning, you experience only half the world. You know, most people are only experiencing half the world most of the time because they are not awake. The mind is tamasic. A tamasic mind does not experience life at all. So if you awaken yourself from within, you will experience the whole world as it is. It is full of consciousness, full of life, full of joy. You must awaken from within. That is why existence is equal to consciousness.
And what about bliss? Like, we say that existence, consciousness and bliss.
And bliss.
So, is bliss different or is it also the same?
No.
See, expression?
Yes. You must understand bliss in depth. See, if you want to build a mature life, you must have a solid idea of what happiness means. Can I tell you for a few minutes? The Vedantic understanding of happiness. See, there are different levels of happiness available to the human experience. What are the different levels? First level is sensory level. See, you eat an ice cream cone. How long can you enjoy it? At the most, 10-15 minutes. Second cone also you may enjoy. Third cone, fourth cone will be terrible for you. Very short level of happiness for very short time, but you invest a whole lot of energy into it. This is the nature of sensory level happiness. The second level of happiness is, all sensory level of happiness falls into this category. Everything that you can have through the senses. The second level of happiness is your thought world. It is more engaging actually, isn't it? Your studies, your intellectual activities, more engaging. It absorbs you all the more, gives a different order of joy. Isn't it? Higher intellectual activity, deeper level engagement, more joy, more lasting joy. The third level is the level of service. See, you make somebody happy, your own mind will be flooded with happiness. It's a strange law in this universe, you know. You make somebody happy, glad, your heart will gladden. You make somebody sad, your heart will sadden. So there are higher and higher levels of joy. The fourth level of joy is the joy of meditation. You still the mind and remain in full awareness. Your mind is flooded with joy. After you come out of that state, your own mind will tell you this is the highest joy. Most long-lasting. So there are levels of joy available to the human experience. And along every level, there are different degrees of joy. Now, for most people, what they mean by increasing happiness is trying to maximize happiness at the sensory level. Collecting more objects, that means. Trying to experience senses more and more. That will not lead to joy, that will lead to frustration. You must climb the ladder to experience more and more happiness. From the sensory level, you go to the mental level. From the mental to the intellectual, service level after that, and meditation. That is the way to increase joy in life. You must climb the ladder. Ladder is always vertical, no? But horizontally, you want to increase happiness. At one level, if you want to collect more objects and try to maximize your happiness, you will go into sorrow. This is the nature of happiness. So they are telling you, self-knowledge, the ultimate goal of meditation, gives you the greatest joy possible, happiness possible for you. It is synonymous with happiness, bliss, what is called. That bliss is all covered up just now. And that's why I require mobile, iPhone to make me happy or keep me engaged. And I require somebody to say good words to me to be happy. Otherwise, I'm sad, you know. This is the state with many people. Somebody or something is required to keep me happy and engaged. By myself, oh, terrible. I'm terrible. See, if you are not happy with yourself, you are in bad company. Isn't it? If you are not happy by yourself. So, understand this. There are different levels of happiness. You must climb the rung of this ladder as you progress with life. Don't remain restricted only to the first level. For children, that is all right. One lollipop and they are happy. But you can never be happy like that. Isn't it? See, your own experience. You don't have to believe me. Someday you will say, oh, one Mataji had said something like this and it's right. It's human experience that I'm talking about, not my experience or your experience. This is the nature of the human mind. Even if you get everything in this world, your mind will ask, what next? This is the nature of human mind. That is why, you know, no culture has made naturalism the architect of its social philosophy. Naturalism means nature is satisfying the human being. No culture will tell you, oh, that nature itself is, means sensory happiness alone is enough. Every culture has developed philosophy, has developed higher thinking, it has developed science. Every culture will tell you the reaches of human mind are very great, very high. Nobody will tell you, be only at the sensory level. That is all. No culture on this planet has made the sensory level the architect of its social philosophy. In fact, it has put it down. Because we know human being itself means you can reach the highest levels of awareness and happiness. You are born erect. You are meant to touch the highest. Yes?
What is the difference between the fourth and fifth states of mind? Huh. If ekagra is not there, how can we get niruddha state?
No, ekagra is required for niruddha state. But niruddha state is complete awakening into full awareness. Where the thought world subsides completely. But ekagrata is still concentration on an object, complete concentration on an object. There's a difference between the two states. Meditation will go from ekagra to niruddha state. This yoga, no, it has to be experienced to be understood. I can't make you understand without the experience. That's why I said practice is so important. Do you get the point? Theoretically, you can't understand it. It must happen in the system. So enter the ekagra state and it will take you to the niruddha state.
Ma'am, you said that there is this unique consciousness or awareness which in itself is manifesting into other bodies and forms.
Yeah.
But as you said, if the sensory intakes are like food for our thoughts, both of us might perceive the same, like actually see the same thing, but perceive it in a different way, and our thoughts arise maybe different in both of us. So where exactly is the difference arising if both of us are made up of the same
very good, very good question. The point is, your memories are different. What creates difference in the same sense intake is that the memory within me is different from the memory within you. So I am adding that memory to my thought process. And so I perceive something a little different from what you are perceiving. We add this memory, you know, whatever you have consciously thought in the past, it goes into your subconscious and becomes your memory. Can I tell you this cycle, how it works? See, whenever you see something through your senses, take in something through your senses, it creates thoughts in your mind. These thoughts don't just remain there in the conscious mind, they will go into the subconscious. You will repeat your thoughts and they will go into the subconscious and become your memory. After some time, they will again fructify into your conscious as thoughts. So then you call them memories, I remembered. Now this memory bank is already in us. So when fresh sense intake comes, I add my memory to that. You understand? That makes the difference. Yes.
Any more questions? No more
Do you want something? You want to ask something?
If somebody was reached the thoughtless state, you know, can he or she, can they live, survive, or they will go?
Can they survive or will they go?
Yeah. Like even after realizing the truth, even after touching that state, is it possible for others to stay, like lead a life or vanish?
See, what you mean by vanish is body will fall.
Body will fall,
isn't it? Usually what happens is a state of the highest realization. One does not want to exist as a limited human being after that. This can happen. But this doesn't mean that a person of realization, his body is going to go. It doesn't mean that. The body can continue. If the prarabdha is there, the body will continue. You must never tamper with as long as the body goes, it should go. You should not tamper with the body at all in this wise. You understand? Trying to put an end to life, it's a crime. It's a great crime. And you will pay for it. Because I told you, it has been given to you for a particular purpose. You must use it towards that purpose. Who are you? What right do you have to put an end to it? So even after realization, if the prarabdha is there, the body will go on. For those in whom the prarabdha is no more there, it has all been worked out, it may fall. But that doesn't mean for every realized person the body is going to fall. You get the point? And never even think of ending life. You don't know what you are ending. Only the body might fall, but the entire package of you, the mind, sanskars, everything will continue. And your problem is with your mind, not with your body. So that same mind is going to continue without body. You will be in greater trouble. Are you getting the point? See, please try to understand what death means. If you want to appreciate life, you must know what death means. After a certain age, this question should come naturally. What is death? Death is only fall of the body. You remember that Panchakosha model? Only the outermost crust falls. The rest of you continue. The mind entirely continues. Intellect continues. Atman, of course, is there. Your sanskars, your bundles, your habits, everything which is enmeshed in that mind, everything will continue. So the same mind will continue. The same mind which wanted to end life and tried to end it is going to continue. So what state you will be in? So never make this mistake of simply trying to end the body. Your problem is with your mind. So learn to stop the mind through training in yoga. That should be the solution, isn't it? That's why I told you, you must be really smart to be spiritual. Yes. Yes. That is called the subtle body. See, you can't see your mind, isn't it? But do you doubt the existence of the mind? Do you doubt? No. It's there. Where is it? Somewhere it is there. You are functioning through it, you know. You have a mind. It continues. Where is your awareness? We know we are aware. Where is it? No localized point. Because it is not in physical space. That space it's got a name in Sanskrit. It's called Chittakash, the mental space. And Chidakash is the awareness space. And this is Sthulakash. Your entire physics only deals with Sthulakash. Physical space in which you find the body. Your thoughts are in mental space, Chittakash. And awareness is Chidakash. So that space continues. The whole of you, almost the whole of you is continuing after death. Body is only the external crust of your personality. That's why don't try to get rid of it. When it will fall by itself. When the prarabdha is done, it will fall.
Continuation of my question, all atmas came from the same Parabrahman.
Yeah.
Why different atma birth, different, sanskaras? That again, why it has to struggle a lot to reach the Parabrahma again?
Why different atmas have different sanskars?
Then again,
see, yeah, the difference is only in the mind, not in your real nature, isn't it? The difference between all of us is in our minds and of course in our bodies, not in your awareness, isn't it? We are all same awareness is there, shining through different minds and bodies. In the Bhagavad Gita, you will find this very beautifully. Lord Krishna says this. I am the Atman shining in all beings. Aham Atma Gudakesha Sarva Bhuta Shayasthitaha. I am that one Atman, the one consciousness shining in all beings through different bodies and minds. one consciousness shining. So the differences in the minds and the bodies. So our problems are with the mind. You must change the nature of the mind. To get this spiritual vision, the mind must have spiritual sanskars, isn't it? Or anything else? Going to Himalayas? Same mind will go. Yes, shall we finish here? One.
Ma'am, you described the five states of mind like Shitta, Vishitta, Mura and others, Ekagra and meditation. You told once that what it is there right now, it was there in someone's mind. Even like Vedanta, it was like someone's mind, right? So if he or she hadn't be in that Shipta and Vishipta state, how he or she developed the new thoughts like Vedanta?
Very good. His question makes a lot of sense. See, isn't Vedanta also a thought construct, he's saying? See, when you construct something on reality, you don't call it a thought construct. Now, suppose I already perceived this lectern. This is already a reality existing here. Then, whatever thoughts I have about this lectern will be thoughts based on that truth. Isn't it? I will not start with doubting, is this lectern here or there or not. So also, awareness is the basic fact of your existence. Because this is the basic substratum of your life process, of your mental world, so we are deliberating on it. And that deliberation is called Vedanta. It is not a thought construct. It is analysis, that's why it's called existential inquiry. Inquiry based upon something already existing, an existential fact. An inquiry based on that is Vedanta. So it will lead you to that truth. This level of knowledge and inquiry will lead you to the truth of that substratum, the experience of it. That is why we don't say Vedanta is a thought construct or a theory. You start with thinking, but you arrive at being. It is not another thought, isn't it? Consciousness, can it be another thought? It is that due to which you are thinking. You may start with this Vedanta charcha, but you arrive at the experience of pure being. You get the point?
If we don't have any more questions, I would like to thank Mataji for this really enlightening speech and such an interactive and helpful session. I would request Professor Ravindra from NIMHANS to present Mataji with a memento. Mr. K.P. Ramesh to present Atma Priyan